Welcome, all you bodhisattvas. Welcome, all bodhisattvas. Pretending to not be bodhisattvas. And we're just kind of like, kind of tired of pretending to die. You know, death is just a pretense. It's just a fantasy pretense. That's all it is. It's ridiculous. And it really is. Whoops, let me turn this the other way. So here we are in apocalyptic California with fires raging everywhere. People say they are with the smoke. The air is just, you know, full of smoke still. It's been raging for like over a month now. State is burning. So get ready for that to come to your neighborhood as well. Welcome, bodhisattvas here. Let us remind ourselves, we are all great bodhisattvas, actually, already. And the no attainment is the attainment. This is, has to be very clear, no attainment is the attainment. Give up the belief in attainment. The best thing we can do, give up this silly notion of attainment. How could we possibly believe in attainment unless we believe in time, space, process, and form? In reality is, there's no attainment. Everything is spontaneously, instantly, spontaneously true. Resolved from the first into its own spontaneity, into the spontaneity of the allness, so to speak. It's all effortless. There's no attainment. Trying to change what we are is what we call attainment. You think, yeah, I need to attain something. No, give up the belief in attainment. I need not attain anything. In fact, there's nothing to attain at all. There's nothing to attain at all. Just meditate on that. There's nothing to attain at all. Now, it's a nice summer evening here in California. I put in a very intense workout. Now, you may be wondering, okay, what am I doing with the... let me grab the skateboard here. Come on out, skateboard. Okay. Yeah. The skateboard. What am I doing with the skateboard? Nothing. Nothing. Nothing yet. So this is a very nice lesson we have here. I'm a student teacher is what I really am right now. My role is a student teacher working under Longchenpa, directly supervised by Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodro, who you will hear more about in the days ahead for sure. So I'm doing some student teaching here. What we wanted to focus on is this: the skateboard. You get something and like a skateboard and you think, oh, okay, I got to use it right away. How do I, oh, freak out, you know, oh, it's so dangerous, I can't, you know, this is too scary, let me put it away, uh-oh, or I get hurt or something. But I'm not doing that. What am I doing? I'm working out intensely on balance exercises and lateral flexibility, lateral strength, overall cat-likeness, you might say. Putting myself in all sorts of awkward positions, and I haven't started tumbling yet, but we'll see if I can start on that too. And I talked to an skateboard expert today on falling, and he gave me some pointers, and that says, don't try to brace yourself, like, just kind of pull yourself in and just roll. If it's not too bad, just roll, or just skid. If it's on your back, just skid. Don't try to throw your arms or hands or elbows or something and stop, or just skid, unless it's you're going real fast, which I won't be going real fast. So he gave me some pointers on that. And so I'm just working out on the skills you need to skateboard, but I'm not skateboarding. It'd be stupid to skateboard, wouldn't it? It'd be stupid. So guess what? The spiritual path is similar to getting a skateboard. You're aware of abidance. You're aware that there is this inexpressible experience that we are, which is freedom. And so do you just try to jump into that freedom Or do you work out getting more and more acclimatized to it so you can just, so you can abide in that? It's a question, right? And so the ego says, oh yeah, here's a skateboard. Now you're great. You could ride your skateboard. Well, let me see you ride your skateboard. And then, of course, you're going to wipe out. We have a acquaintance that told us that their boss, their kids were skateboarding or something, got a, and they got a skateboard, whatever. And he said, he was showing them. He said, here, let me show you how to skateboard. He flipped off, fell down, hit his hip, broke his hip. He's in a wheelchair now. Okay, he was an idiot. Got carried away. He got trapped. He got tricked by youth. And wanting to be a hero to show, oh yeah, I'm still young. I can do this, no problem. Okay, this is a very dangerous thing. So what I'm highlighting is here, I'm showing us. Okay, we have something really cool. We have this really cool skateboard, and it symbolizes something very free and simple, doesn't it? Yeah. But I'm saying, okay, you know, it. One step at a time. Take it slow. I mean, I'm not interested in having accidents or being harmed in any way. It doesn't interest me. I'm not accident prone. I never have been. So, because I try to, you know, I'm cautious, which is a good thing. Don't be a hero. You end up a zero. Don't try to be a hero. That's a little too much light. So work, but work out on what you need to work out on. Keep working out. Keep building your strength, spiritual strength. Keep building your spiritual strength. Just be smart about it. Be wise. Don't overdo it. And I put in a really a very nice workout today. Was really sweaty. It was good, but I feel okay. I don't feel like I overdid it. And the balance exercise is getting a lot easier now. It's quickly. It hasn't taken long. It's like just about a week or so. I've had the Bosu ball, and already my ankles, knees, everything. I'm able to just do all this changing of balance and shifting. All, and my upper body just stays calm, like it's almost stationary. It's just everything, my ankles and everything are just moving beautifully and handling all the shifts of balance, all the awkwardness. This is very great spiritual training, actually. There's all this awkwardness. The world's nothing but awkwardness, actually. But to be able to be calm, up your mind calm, while nature is all awkward, is our goal, actually. At least nature thinks it's awkward, but we don't have to believe it. We don't have to believe anything nature tells us, actually. N Jesus says nature don't value it at all. It tells you nothing about what you are, just the opposite, actually. So nature may say, yeah, I'm awkward, I'm troublesome. Well, we don't have to believe any of that, do we, actually? No, we don't. We can see it as it really is everything. Release, self-release from the beginning into its in its own inherent spaciousness. There's nothing going on, nothing being transferred, actually. It's just a play of light, of decoration, of ornamentation. Now, it helps. I've skateboarded before when I was young. And so I said, yeah, you know, I'm not really, you know, like, oh, this is something brand new. You know, I've never, I've forgotten what it's like, but I'm not really eager to do it. I'm not really eager. but it helps me as a fitness goal. I mean, it's something I use to get me to keep working out. It's just like I use golf to get me, you know, in really good shape, and then I found out I'm not really interested in playing golf anymore. You know? So I'm using the skateboard to get myself in better shape, you know, better goals. Well, maybe I might use this fitness for something entirely different, right? So it could just be a prop, an expedient, but you know, you need expedience in your life. You have to have these, something that motivates you. Now, what, I don't know, what is it that I'll do? I don't know. I use singing to motivate me too. It's what's it going towards? I don't know. I don't know. I guess you find out when you get there. I'm singing. I had a huge revelation today and breakthrough. This is what we're leading up to. We're getting into the video now, and so we can talk about something really profound. How far are we into it? 10 minutes. Great. We can really talk about something profound here. And I've had like a sea change in my psyche, which is great. And I'm making this turnaround, big turnaround, and I'm still working on it, but it's come a long way. That I would rather be a background singer, backing up, like, you know, an absolutely incredibly great lead vocalist, than be a lead vocalist in some band of my own. Even if I was a really good vocalist, I would rather be just a background vocalist doing chorus and doubling on the leads, doubling and accenting and stuff, you know, to make the whole sound sweeter and fuller and richer and better sounding. So the lead singer, you know, sounds even better. But I'd rather do that than have my own band. That's a huge, complete 180 for me. So what I'm doing when I'm listening to songs now, I listen to two artists, Beach Boys and George Jones, in my opinion, the two best artists of the 20th century. And I love both of them. They're both just, you know, top notch. But now I'm just singing background. Whereas before, I always doubled up on the lead. Like I was just practicing to be a, you know, lead singer. Now the song starts and I'm just doing ooh, you know, ooh, 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 ah, and just da 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 dum dum dum, ba 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 boom. I'm doing all the background singing. And, you know, inventing some and adding accents and, you know, bringing all the juice to the background. And you know what that does? It makes the lead sound better. It makes the lead singer sound better. Which is the whole point of it. Now, how is this spiritual? It's very spiritual. This is very much to the point of what we're getting at here. Because what we're getting at is the big picture here. The big picture. And just like music is driven by stars, okay, so is the spiritual culture driven by stars. Just look at history, the stars, spiritual stars that have come into the world and the effect they had on the world. And they have a much better effect if they have some around them to make them look, you know, really shine, make it sound richer overall, you know, like a band. And you got a great, like George Jones had when he recorded, he had the Jordanaires backing him up, and some of his gospel songs, one album he had the Nashville Edition, which is just a fabulous song. It's called Hallelujah Weekend. That CD or album, Hallelujah Weekend, good Lord, it's some of the best music you're ever going to hear. It's just so well produced and sung. The Nashville Edition and the Jordanaires both sang on those songs. And just the sound is just rich, 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 rich. And then Jones comes in and just, you know, just does his thing that he can't miss. And the overall sound is just fabulous. Well, it's the same thing what Jesus had as apostles, did he not? Buddha had his, the Arhants and the Bodhisattvas and the Sangha and those that, you know, that gathered around Buddha, right, and juiced the whole thing up, made it really big. That's where it's at, actually, historically. That's where it's really at. And so for me, that's where it's at. I'm seeing that more and more and more and more. Very few stars, you know, there's a certain star quality, and I understand that. I don't really have it at this point. Just like singing lead, I can double on lead really well, but I can't quite, I don't have quite the capability to be like a lead singer, to be out there, just do the lead singing. It's not quite good enough, which is okay, but I'm very good at background singing and filling in, very, very creative and confident and good at that. But what that does, it makes the lead singer sound even better. And so this is really what we're supposed to be doing. At least myself, most certainly, is make the stars sound better so people will be really attracted to these stars, because these stars really deliver. You know, Jesus really delivers. Buddha really delivers. Longchenpa really delivers. These are superstars. And to be asked like to sing, you know, in their band as background singer, so to speak, you know, wow, that's really great. You know, Elvis had the Jordanaires backing him up. He had a great band playing for him, really. Elvis had just like the best. Burton on guitar. The drummer. I mean, he just had the best musicians and then the best backup singers. Jordanaires and some other singers. Oh, you know. So, you know, Elvis is like the king. He gets out there and he delivers, you know. He's got the charisma. He's got the lead voice and everything. But man, did he have a great backup band and backup musicians. And when he recorded the best, you know, American Sound Studios in Memphis, you know, where his comeback, Suspicious Minds in the Ghetto, that return album that he made, he had the Memphis horns on that, and the studio musicians in American Sound Studio, I think in Memphis, All American Studio, something like that, and yeah. Just great, 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 great backup musicians and singers and stuff. But then, Elvis then delivers the song. And, you know, great, great songs. He's great at it. So, you know, I'm happy doing that right now, is being a backup, being part of the studio backup, whatever, you know. Doing that, and boosting the overall ambience, you know, of the Dharma Kings. Because they're the ones that are going to deliver. It's a tough job. I mean, it's a big task right now, isn't it? And we're all thinking like, wow, this is too much. Well, is it too much to sing background harmony? Maybe not. If we try to be the stars, well, maybe that is too much. But if we're willing to play a bit role in some way and add to the overall ambience, yeah, why not? So I'm coming around to this viewpoint. I love the viewpoint. I love it. It's very new for me. It's like big, big wow. I've never tried to sing back. I've just done it my whole life just for fun. But in my mind, I never saw myself as a backup singer. So I didn't even, I was listening to doo-wop last night. And, you know, I listening to Dion, which is my favorite artist of the 50s and early 60s, as far as doo-wop it goes. I mean, Dion led to Belmonts were fabulous. And, but I could do it easy. It's like, wow, yeah, I got no problem doing that. I could just fit right in. You know, take a little, adjustment as far as just like if you're in really good shape, you can pretty much do much any athletic activity. You need, you need to get used to it and do it. We had a friend that was just in fabulous condition as a soccer player. He's just a genius, and he decided to take up surfing just for the fun of it. He said, "Yeah, it looks like fun. I'll try it." Within like 6 months, he was a really good surfer, and we had been surfing for years and years and years, and we were still lousy. But for him, he was such a great athlete. It was easy, and boy, was he a good surfer. And he's like, okay, that was fun. But there was no trouble for him. He had super balance and flexibility and alertness and everything. He's just a star athlete. So when you have these certain qualities, musical qualities, it's not difficult. It takes a little adjustment, but it's not difficult. I don't feel any difficulty doing it. I can just do it cold. I just go into a song and just right away, just fit right in. But the lead singers, the stars, they have a slightly different quality. You can't, it's really difficult to assess it and learn it. And it's a kind of confidence. It's some sort of really, really smooth confidence they have. And the audience can feel it. And can tell, and it's just this sort of relaxed, smooth. It's like, I got this, don't worry, to the audience. And the audience feels at ease. They put the audience at ease because they're not straining, they're not trying, they're just like, oh, this is easy, man, no problem. Don't, because the audience doesn't want them to fail. They say, I hope they can do it, I hope they can do it. And then the star comes out and says, folks, I'm gonna knock you out. It's easy, no problem, don't worry. I'll deliver. I'm going to deliver here, and they just deliver. It's like easy, and the audience just they just love that. They just love it. Whereas if you get someone out there saying, "I'm going to really try really hard," the audience goes, "Uh-oh, is this going to work?" So the Dharma Kings, they know their business, and they're knockout artists, and they know, we're going to knock you out for sure. You're going to be knocked out. It's already a done deal. So everybody goes, ah, great. And they relax. You don't want someone coming and say, I'm going to try to knock you out. You don't want an anesthesiologist coming in and saying, you know what? This is great. I'm going to really try really hard to knock you out and put you under, man. I'm going to really, I'm going to, I think I'm, might be able to do this. Is that what you want, an anesthesiologist? Or do you want someone to come in and say, anesthesiologists are a breed apart, right? I mean, they come in and tell the person, says, like, hey, I've been doing this all my life. I'm going to give you the beautiful sleep, And they just have this super confident air about them. They have to, because the patients are like really jittery. So, doc, I don't want to wake up and they're sawing, cutting on me. I mean, you're going to keep me asleep. I mean, you're going to, He says, oh, man, I'm just joking and relax. And they have this demeanor like, hey, I can't fail. I can't miss. I can't miss. I just can't miss. They have to be very confident anesthesiologists. The patients, they just give them heck, They're just like, the patients are freaking out before the surgery, right? It's horrible going under their knife. I can't even imagine it. I've never gone under the knife, and I don't plan on it. Thanks, but no thanks. When you're dropping your pre when we're dropping our pretense, we're like, wow, this is kind of scary, So the star has to just reassure them like an anesthesiologist, except in reverse. A reverse anesthesiologist is, hey, you're in great hands, right? Great hands. And the nurses always tell you, oh, the doctor, he's the best, He's the best, don't worry. Oh, he's great, you're really in great hands. And they all say that, so you kind of go, oh, good. Are you a good doc? Oh, he's like the top one in the hospital, the top one. They probably say it about every single anesthesiologist. They say, I don't say this about everyone, but I tell you what, you're really lucky that, because you got this anesthesiologist. What, wow, is he good? He's just been doing it for so long, and he never misses. But the gurus, they never, the Dharma Kings, they can't miss. See, they can't miss. And so, you can't, I can't sing that song. I can't be that lead singer who I can't miss that thing. They know they can't miss. It's impossible to miss for them to miss. So it makes us just, it reassures us. All I have to say is Longchamp is in the house, and I just got immediately, my worries like just seemed to like dissipate. I just said, wow. It's like an instant wow. It's like an ultimate reverse anesthesiologist has just walked into the room. And your worries, as a patient, you just subside. And you smile and say, thank you, doc. Yeah, thanks for being here. I know you'll take great care of me. He says, you bet I will. Can't miss. So we want these can't miss reverse anesthesiologists, reverse spiritual anesthesiologists. We want them, these are the ones we want. Okay? We don't want just some guru walking in and says, yeah, I'm really gonna try to awaken you, I'm really gonna make a big effort to do so. They say, oh, I mean, can't you? Don't you have some, Dharma king they're connected with? Can you ask them to come here? I kind of rather have them do it. So, I'm very big on being connected with the Dharma king. And being part of that. Being part of it, rather than just being a solo, I'm gonna go do it on my own sort of thing. Because when there's crises and there's as there will be in this world, you don't want to just call on any guru. You want to call on the top dog in the hospital. We want to. Top reverse anesthesiologist in the hospital, and we want them to show up and so people can relax, because you try to do it and you and they say, can you miss? Do you think it's possible you might miss? Well, I'm gonna try real hard not to miss. They don't want to hear that. They want to hear, and they want to know, they want to feel the confidence that says, I can't miss. It's impossible, absolutely impossible that I miss. Everybody with them breathe a sigh of relief. We'll all breathe a big sigh of relief. We need a sigh of relief, don't we? I mean, the cuckoos in the world, there's crazy in the world, isn't there? And they seem to be running the asylum. More and more running the asylum, and they're mocking the therapists. So anyone who wants to help them out, try to at least try to fix stuff. They say, you're not good enough to fix it, forget it. They're not really, it's kind of like they don't want it fixed. Pharmaceutical companies don't want it fixed, and they fund a lot of these activists, actually, believe it or not. There's all sorts of tricky networks of activism that end up promoting all these activists, and somehow, one way or another, they get funded, don't they? And hands off, nothing happens to them. The law doesn't touch them, and all they got lawyers that help them and everything. This is all being funded by some very big fat cats. Behind the scenes, who don't want us to get well, don't want us to have guru vision. They love exploiting us. We make a lot of money, then they take steal it from us. It's like for them, it's like, wow, this is fun. But if we're not here making a lot of money, then how can they steal it from us? If we turn our bodies into light, how are they going to exploit that? They don't want that. They want us to think we're human beings and nature is our home. And they're really clever at exploiting this. And they want to keep that going. And the Dharma kings want to liberate us from that. So they're out there doing their, activist thing. And we're here doing our liberation thing. Dharma King thing. But we better do our thing really well because they'll do their thing well. I mean, they're just like a drug addict, they do what the pusher tells them to do. The pusher says do this, they do it, don't they? The pusher says do something nasty, they do it. I mean, they're desperate. So the activists are quite desperate. They don't want anything fixed here. anyone stands up and says, I want to reform, they say, whoa, 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 whoa. We're having a great time stealing everyone blind. You know, we don't want any reform. There's a reformist in the Philippines, Duterte, Rodrigo Duterte, and he's having to move real, real fast to try to stay ahead of all the corruption and the crooks who love to put him out of business. But in the Philippines, you can move a lot faster than you can here, right? So you could, it's, they have a possibility of bringing reform to the Philippines. He's a really great reformer. He reformed Davao. He's an extraordinary reformer, very tough. And he puts the crooks in jail. The judges, the politicians, he names names, he arrests them, puts them in jail, says, you'll have your day in court. He moves fast. It's shutting down the drug trade in the Philippines. There's a horrible problem in the Philippines, drug trade. And he's shutting it down. And the Philippine people, they like that. They say, this is great. But here in America, you have a reformer stand up and says, hey, I'm going to shut down the corruption. There's so much corruption. The lobbyists, Wall Street, the healthcare industry, all this stuff is so utterly corrupt. These politicians are totally corrupt, which is true. Politicians are so corrupt. You get someone standing up and say, hey, I'm a reformer. I'm going to name names. I'm going to prosecute. I am going to get rid of this corruption in our country, United States. And immediately these corrupt people, they start funding all these activists. Yeah, rent a mob, rent activists. They're paid. They're paid to do all this stuff. Sneakily, of course. But this has been going on for a long, long time. You know, this should be exposed. It's been exposed, but nobody seems to care at all. Anyway, we're scared of reform. We're really scared of reform. In America, everything runs so slowly, we can't reform. This is the weakness of America. If it ever gets corrupt, which it has, it's more corrupt than anybody knows, actually. Nothing has been reformed about Wall Street and all the banks and all the stuff. Nothing's been reformed. And they're terrified that someone might get in the White House and actually start reforming it. It's their worst nightmare. So they're funding all the media and all this activism to, you know, just try to destroy a potential reformer. But the way the country is it's very difficult to reform once it gets corrupt whereas in other countries that they're a little more despotic, you get a real good reformer in there, they can actually accomplish something. But good luck reforming America right now. The people I talk to say it's not possible. I don't think it's possible. I really don't. The legal roadblocks, the way the judicial system, legal system, the way the activists are being funded and everything, they just absolutely put it into gridlock and they just continue on business as usual here. It's just utterly corrupt America in so many ways. So it's a socially corrupt culture. And it doesn't seem like we're going to be able to change that at all. So okay, it's fine. We'll see what we'll take care of the business of the Dharma Kings. We'll align ourselves with their business. Switch cultures. Go into Dharma King culture. That's what I'm doing. I'm going into Dharma King culture. Okay, because I now finish with American culture. It's been dead for a long time. And it's been on Skid Row for a long time. So Dharma King culture is the future. It really is. It really is. And we'll just say sayonara to the pharmaceutical, corporate, bankster, you know, rob you blind, greedy, materialistic, yoga girl culture. We'll just say goodbye to that culture. We're not interested in it anymore, that's all. Maybe later. But not right now. We're not interested in it. We're interested in Dharma King culture. DKC, Dharma King culture. Okay, so just start saying, you know what? I'm making a shift. Because you're going to have to make a decision of what direction you're going. And so I'm trying to just promote the options so you can see, hey, I can decide to join Dharma King culture. Got some good singers there, got some good entertainment, got some great, you know, artists, great culture, great teaching, great teachers, wonderful austerity and discipline and success and liberation and bliss and freedom and all this Dharma King culture. That if you want success, that's where you go. If you want to be robbed blind, just stay with the modern culture. So we know how the game is being played now, and so there's no point in, you know, beating a dead horse. It's just time to move on from it. You talk about moveon.org. Well, you know, we're really moving on. We're moving on from moveon.org, right? We're moving on from that. They're now, you know, just in the, you know, we're leaving the ghetto. All right, it's just a ghetto. This world's just a ghetto, plain and simple. And of course, the people in the ghetto, they don't like anyone leaving it. Even in the United States, for instance, a lot of inner cities are ghettos. And those who get out of the ghetto, it's very difficult. But those who do, the people in the ghetto, they don't like them anymore. They say, you don't belong to us anymore. Who do you think you are leaving the ghetto? You think you're too good for us? I say, you know, they should say, well, who do you think you are living in the ghetto? You think you're not good enough to live somewhere else? I mean, who do you think you are pretending that you're not good enough? That you're supposed to live in the ghetto. So that's a pretense, you know? I mean, who are you to try and change what you are? You know, you're bodhisattva. You know, who are you trying to kid? That's how we have to look at it. So you want to keep living in the ghetto? Okay, but who are you trying to kid? You're trying to kid a bodhisattva. It doesn't work. It doesn't work at all. I mean, we say you're a bodhisattva trying to kid another bodhisattva. Come on, you know, it doesn't work. They try to say, no, you're a human being. You're easy to kid. Say, no, I'm not a human being. I'm a bodhisattva. And you can't kid me. You can't fool me. So, you know, let them cry their beer. Maybe they'll start listening to George Jones. You know, and maybe they'll say, hey, at least there's something good about this, you know, honky-tonk. And maybe they'll sober up a little bit. Yeah. They'll sober up sooner or later, won't they? So they keep trying to frame the whole thing, you know, within their parameters. And, you know, sorry. You know, they're not framing my parameters at all. Don't let them frame your parameters. You have the option of Dharma King culture. So many of you do. You may not realize it. So many of you have this option. Really, it's right there in front of you. Now, what's the big scariest? Oh, you don't want direct contact with the Dharma Kings. It's, you know, it scares the heck out of you. It's kind of like a singer, like a bar singer, you know. Suddenly George Jones walks into the bar. They says, hey, you're a singer, huh? Singer says, no, I'm not a singer, no, I'm just here drinking. Like, whoa, you know, I don't want to sing with him, I'm going to sound terrible. Well, sing backup then, you know. You can sing, if you're a good bar singer, you can sing backup. Yeah, Jones says, hey, can you sing backup for me? You know, I'd say, sure. Because you know what? This is the key you need to understand. He's such a great singer that it doesn't even matter how you sound back up. You could be croaking and it would sound great. he can't miss. He won't let the song sound bad. It's impossible. So all you gotta do is get up there on stage and you know, like a fish. But you could do some oohs and some ahs and woo. And yeah, I mean, you know, after a while, you realize the audience is not paying attention to you anyway. And he's going to sound so good, they're going to just love it. So the pressure's off of you. So what the Dharma Kings do is they take the pressure off of you. They really take the pressure off of you. But we're all so scared of direct contact with them. We're so scared of it. And what happens is we end up becoming too erudite in You know, like how many angels can dance on the head of a pin? And we're like spending all our time talking about that. So yeah, I've had much direct contact with the Dharma kings. So I'm used to it. I'm used to it. I'm used to it. That's a good thing. That's super helpful for everyone. And it's like, yeah, you could get used to it. I mean, they're very nonchalant and relaxed and at ease. They're not asking you to sing lead, you know, they're not asking you to do too much. They said, hey, maybe you could, you know, sing back up in my band someday. Well, you know, I'd like to love to have you. And it's like, huh? But we keep thinking, I gotta sing lead, I gotta sing. No, you don't. Let them sing, do the singing. You know, do that for a while. Do that for a while. What do you got to lose? I mean, you help them out, and they help many, many, many out, which also helps you out, you see? So it's a win, 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 win. Every way you look at it, it's a win, 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 win. So my whole life, I've had many erudite people contact me. I've been contacted by many because they think maybe maybe I can help them. Maybe they'll understand me. And they all end up, you know, thinking I'm an idiot or a knucklehead, or and eventually they have to say I'm arrogant or insolent, or you know, they don't like me. Because, you know, I can't seem to help them. But I'm not willing to, you know, I don't need the erudition at all. But I've never been quite sure what to say to them, you know, and they get frustrated. But I do know what to say now, and that's that they need direct contact with the gurus, the Dharma kings. That's it. Those are stuck, and so many are stuck in trying to figure out how many angels can dance on the head of a pin. They're stuck there, and they just, you know, it's like terrible. So I say, just ease into contact with the Dharma kings. That's all you need to do. Just ease into it. And I could help with that because I've already done it. The latest was Padmasambhava. Yeah, that was really cool. And I was nervous. Yeah, I was in a dream, but it's like, wow. It's like. Okay, this is really, really something. But it was casual, you know. I mean, the whole dream was symbolized for me, but it was casual, and there's nothing upsetting happening or anything like that. I just like, it's like, my gosh, you know, this is really amazing, really astonishing. But really, the Dharma kings, they're just here to help us and to be our friends, and most everyone in the world just ignores them, totally ignores them. The idea of being their friends, friending them, never occurs to hardly anyone. So imagine them, they just say, wow, you know, they're just waiting for us. Imagine how happy they are when someone says, hey, you know, Padmasambhava, I'd really like to friend you. I said that, I'd really like to friend you. You know, I'm ready for that. Immediately, he responded like that. Said, yeah. Sure, that's great. Thanks for asking. You think these superstars have all these good friends? No, they don't. Everyone's too afraid of them. They say, oh, they might ask me to sing. Oh, I gotta stay away from them. They're not gonna ask you, hey, jump up on stage. We really need you to sing lead on it. You know, no. They say, hey, if you want, you know, why don't you sing, you know, you can say, why don't you help me out and sing backup? You know, it really helped me sound even better. Oh, yeah. Wow. Okay. I'll think about that. So, easing into contact with the Dharma kings is the cure for our ills. And our ills take many, many different forms, don't they? And you know, so many people contact me, and they're all stuck, and they think maybe you might be able to help me. Yeah, it's because I'm very super confident because I've already done it, and I've already had contact, great deal of contact with the Dharma kings, direct contact. So I've already done it, and I know it can be done. So I have this super confidence. Yeah, absolutely, you can do it. You will do it. You will do it. It's not anything as difficult as you might think of it, it certainly requires, it's like, oh my gosh. Yeah, it requires a great deal of discipline and patience as you get you over the shock of it all. Like I said, I thought I would be an idiot forever, but it doesn't look like it's my destiny's going that way anymore. Wow, I got a new destiny. Like, oh my gosh, new death. Yeah, and so this new destiny unfolds in front of you. It's like, it's really just like, wow. So you're pretty much in a wowness all the time. I've been in the wowness for a long time. It just seems to never stop. Overall, you get more and more relaxed, more and more confident. But they understand the issue. We need to ease into it. Longchenpa sent Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodo to me. Says, here, this be less stressful on you. I say, oh yeah. I mean, meeting Longchenpa, the more you find out about him, the more it's like, wow. Ignorance is bliss for a while, isn't it? Yeah, I don't know who this guy is, but he sure is, sure have been very impressive. He's like a lead singer, It's like, hey, and people say, do you know who that was? And I say, no. So that was Elvis, What? Really? Well, that was George Jones. That was George Jones? Really? I didn't know that. Who's George Jones? And then you find out, you say, oh my gosh, I was hanging out with the possum. Wow. And then you start getting more like, oh, I can't do that, but at first you don't know who it is. It's like, yeah, wow, really nice guy, very nice guy, very confident guy, very at ease. Like the world doesn't bother. He knows it's a crisis. The world doesn't bother him the slightest bit. It's like I say, hey, Longchenpa, it's a really tough audience, man. I've been trying. It's tough. He just laughs. He says, let me handle the audience. Let me handle this audience, okay? Don't worry about it. I said, really? You can handle this audience? Wow. That's amazing. It's like, why do some comedians get the laughs and others don't? It's quite astonishing, isn't it? Because they're not afraid of the audience. They say, I can handle this audience. I'll have them, on the ground laughing, no question about it. And so the audience thinks, ah, who's this comedian? Comedian says, look, audience, I've already got you. I can't miss. You think Jim Carrey is scared of an audience, No. He's got the goods. He knows. He knows what he's got. Audience, where I would say that we're a tough audience, and Jim Carrey says, oh, you're a tough audience. Says, oh, great. I love tough audiences. Those are my favorite kind. He's not worried. And the audience says, oh, wow. Well, he's not worried. And he says, don't worry. I'll take it easy on you. You won't die laughing. I promise you won't die laughing. You're going to laugh really hard, but you're not going to die laughing. Okay, I'll back off a little bit. Just like that, really like a great comedian like Jim Carrey, he's like, says, if I really want to, I could, lay it on, thicker and thicker and thicker here, but I'll take it easy on you tonight. Don't worry, folks. And then they say, oh, okay, thanks. I mean, laughing is a pretty strong exercise, isn't it? If you spend like hours laughing, whoa, you're gonna be you're sore, 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 sore. Good Lord, you have to be in really great shape to laugh well. That's why kids can laugh so nicely, so wonderfully. They're in such great flexibility and shape, and they could really laugh. But adults, it's hard for us to laugh. They'll be like, we can't laugh anymore. Cannot laugh anymore. Ah, yeah, But the kids, oh, they're rolling on the floor laughing, aren't they? They're just in stitches. Isn't how cool is that, right? Remember that when you used to like be able to really laugh? How long has it been since you've really laughed? How long has it been since we've really experienced something sublime, like a Dharma king putting the pedal to the floor? best band I ever heard live was the Edgar Winter Band, and we didn't go there for that. In fact, we didn't want to hear him at all. We said we just hoped Johnny Winter would show up, as Edgar's brother, because Johnny Winter was a big star at that time. He was a really hot blues guitarist, really quite extraordinary. And we thought, you know, Johnny's often shows up at Edgar's concert, so we thought we're gonna go. We went to see Edgar. Edgar Winter wasn't even headlining. It was Humble Pie was headlining at Winterland in San Francisco. So we went to see there just to hope that Johnny showed up. Well, the Edgar Winter Band jumped on the stage and kicked it off. Man, they kicked out the floodlights. I mean, they just blew the doors off the place. I was just like, my jaw just dropped. I said, are you kidding me? What the heck? Because before, they were like a horn band doing a bunch of jive stuff up in Harlan. Like, turn on your love light, you know. You know, just all this kind of jazzy, bluesy horn stuff. It's like I didn't even like that music. I said, ah, I don't like that stuff. So we thought they'd be terrible. But they start the song, and what was they start out with? Keep playing that rock and roll, I think. Keep playing that rock and roll. And they're suddenly with this like incredible rock and roll band with Chuck Ruff on drums, I believe. Randy Joe Hobbs on bass. Rick Derringer was there on lead guitar. Dan Hartman on rhythm guitar. And Edgar Winter on just about everything. Saxophone, synthesizer, keyboards, vocals, timbales, you know, just. And they just absolutely put on the best rock and roll show you ever want to see in your life. And I was a fan, an instant fan after that. Instant fan for many years. I mean, that was like a super group. Super, super group. If you don't know, Randy Joe Hobbs was the bass player for Johnny Winter. Very good bass player. Dan Hartman went on to be a disco star. He was just a super, super talented. I didn't know who he was. Nobody knew who he was. He died early because he just pushed it too hard. Pushed it too hard. Yeah, led the fast life, the whole disco cocaine thing, you know, just he burned himself out and died. But what a super, super talented musician Dan Hartman was. And of course, Rick Derringer's still playing. Rick Derringer's one of the best rock and roll guitar players of all time. And then Edgar Winter is one of the most talented musicians, you know, you're ever going to see. And the band just absolutely torched the place. And poor Humble Pie came on, and we just, I mean, nobody cared. We tried to get into it, they tried, but I mean, it was just like, are you kidding me? You don't want to follow the Edgar Winter Band. Believe me, there is no way. If I was a musician, I just wouldn't even want to walk on stage after that. Because they were just crazy. I mean, Rick Derringer back in the day was an astonishing guitar player. And they all blended together. You had like a super, super group that was just knocking it out, knocked everybody out. I said, okay, forget about Johnny. I forgot about Johnny. Johnny showed up, never showed up. You know, so what? That would have been a come down, actually, after what we heard. So you don't know what you're going to get necessarily, right? I mean, sometimes this unknown, something unknown, is going to just knock you out. Sometimes there's stars you don't even know about, and you just stumble upon them like I did then. I just stumbled upon it, just like, wow. And they had some great albums in the I think it was the 70s, just super, super music. I listen to it all the time. I was a huge, huge Edgar Winter fan, and the sound that they had, it was beautifully done and super talented. So the point is that we don't know when we're going to stumble across something that's going to knock us out and change our lives. That changed my life, that going to that concert. It really changed my life. My musical taste changed. I dropped Johnny Winter pretty much. Before then, I was actually trying to be, you know, Johnny Winter Jr. And I could play like Johnny Winter, but, you know, again, not as good. I played blues guitar. I played it really fast. I could do a pretty good imitation of Johnny Winter, that is for sure. But not in the same class of him at all. I mean, he'd blow me off the stage, because he did actually finger picking. He had picks on his fingers, and he was, you know, just you know, the real deal as far as a all in musician goes. But so I was on that track, trying to reach, you know, some apex in blues rock sort of genre. And, you know, sometimes I could play so fast, it was scary. I was automatic. Like, I could just do it. And I would just sit there watching myself, and my body was just playing, and I was not even thinking that I was even playing at all. I was just mentally just an observer or something. And I could just play for hours, just like at lightning speed, for hours, because I practice like 10 hours a day. But here at Edgar Winter Band, I realized there's something to be said for slowing things down and sing nice, beautiful singing and beautiful songs and just, you know, like a beautiful vibe. I haven't listened to those songs in a long time. Jasmine Night Dreams is one of his albums. Really great album. That was my favorite album at the time. Jasmine Night Dreams, I believe. And there's All American Boy, I think, was before that. That was with Dan Hartman. Just, you know, great, great songs. Free Ride was one of them. Of course, Frankenstein was a big hit for them. Free Ride was a beautiful song. I used to play that song. I used to play those songs, be able to play those songs. Rock and Roll Hoochie Coo played that song really well. I could do, you know, all that kind of stuff. So I started shifting towards, away from the hard life of a virtuoso, let me knock you out by, you know, like Johnny Winter sort of thing. And Eric Clapton and, you know, Jimi Hendrix and all those influences. Started going away from that and, you know, saved my life, because those guys, you know, Clapton survived. I think Johnny Winter's still alive, but they went through hell and heroin, you know, and Jimi Hendrix didn't survive, and a lot of them didn't survive. Dan Hartman didn't survive. It burns you out. I was burning myself out, because you're trying to deliver something, you know, that's just a constant stream of knockoutness. But there's something to be said for understatedness. And allowing your own being to knock yourself out, instead of someone trying, you know, someone else knocking you out, invite your own knockout, so to speak. And this is what George Jones, and then eventually I ended up listening to George Jones, who's the greatest at that. He gives you space to knock yourself out. That's the genius of this classic country, the style they had. It's so slow paced, and you can understand the words, and they're relaxed. It's like there's all this space for you as the listener to add something in your own listening creativity to it and feel like you're part of it. It's not like something being dictated to you. You know, you're invited into the song. Yeah, that was a really new experience for me. It was extraordinary. So initially I was on the track towards being a musical virtuoso, which I wasn't in my previous life, but I shifted over to guitar. And, you know, I was hell on wheels on guitar, to say the least. You know, I was the guy that played, you know, super loud, super fast, is super soulful. You know, I love Freddie King and B.B. King and all the Kings and, you know, Chuck Berry and all that stuff. But it was more towards, you know, the virtuoso type of thing. You have the virtuosos now, like Eddie Van Halen and, what is it, Steve Vai and Santorini and, you know, Eric Johnson and on and on and on and on, right? Malmsteen from Wiggy, what's it, Wiggy, not Malmsteen from Sweden. And, but there's a bunch of new ones that keep coming along, right, right? James Burton, of course, but he was understated. He was a studio guy, more like more. I was in that genre, and then I shifted. Edgar Winter helped me shift into, like, hey, wait a minute, let's bring something more beautiful into this, and some space into this, and then I gradually more and more and more, and ultimately I ended up with George Jones, which, again, the master of inherent spaciousness and singing. And of course, I started out with the Beach Boys. And when, of course, the problem was the British invasion came and screwed everything up. Screwed the Beach Boys up. Screwed everyone in California up, actually. We had this great musical scene out here, and then the British invasion just crushed it, which we didn't really like at all, actually. Not that they weren't talented, but we had our own vibe going here, which was a beautiful thing. You know, the Mamas and the Papas and Buffalo Springfield and the Byrds and the Grateful Dead and Jefferson Airplane. And it went on and on. Creedence Clearwater Revival went on and on and on and on and on and on and on here. And then the British invasion came and just crushed everything. We had the Rascals. Oh, they were great. Just great. The young Rascals. That was an East Coast band, New Jersey, I think, New Jersey, New Yorkish type of thing. And then we had all the doo-wop, you know, Dion, crushed Elvis, crushed everybody, the British invasion, just crushed American music, actually. And so then, we tried to recapture it, you know, by saying, hey, we can do that, we can do this stuff better, you know. And then Clapton and Jimmy Page and, you know, Jeff Beck and all the, you know, virtuosos from England, the British invasion and stuff. We tried to, you know, outdo them, looking for our own, you know, heroes here, guitar heroes and stuff. And then Johnny Winter was like the key one, I think. Hendrix passed away, unfortunately. It was a rough thing. It was a real rough thing. The music scene was really important back in the day. Really, it was just, you know, it was a cultural thing. It was a huge cultural thing. And unfortunately, we went, what I say, in the wrong direction. So I was trying to pull it back somehow. And, you know, there's a lot to say about all that social engineering using music, actually. They didn't really want us listening to the Beach Boys. they didn't really want that. They wanted a sicker society, actually. And of course, the British invasion drove Brian Wilson insane. Pretty much insane. Because he felt he had to compete with it. And so he started taking drugs just to come up with even more beautiful music. And that screwed it all up. And he was the leader, really, of American music. I mean, the Beach Boys were king. Rightfully so. Dion was king before. Elvis was king. And then Dion and then, you know, Beach Boys. So Brian Wilson realized that, you know, the culture, you know, was swinging away from this and getting captured by this British invasion. So he said, I got to do something better and get the audience back. And he couldn't get the audience back. So he said, well, I got to get some help then. You know, maybe the drugs will help me. He was so committed to his music, he was willing to do anything to get the audience back. But what happened was he became overly introspective and basically kind of ended up just living in the studio and just trying to do all this, you know, gimmicky stuff in the studio to try to compete. And then he lost the sound. And a lot of people think, you know, the later stuff is great, but it's not. Pet Sounds and Smile. I mean, there's a bunch of stuff that came out that wasn't as good as the earlier stuff at all, and it got mushier and mushier, and became lost in just, you know, savant overdoing, you know, some savant, what you might call it, studio excess. Savant studioism, you might call it. Savant studioism. And you don't want that. You don't want that. The Beatles were able to avoid that better than the Beach Boys. They had enough input from different angles, and George Martin, the producer, you know, had a lot of control, and they were, you know, they managed to avoid the worst of that. Whereas Brian Wilson was the Beach Boys, and so when he got, you know, too overwhelmed by it and tried to bring it back and was struggling, they just couldn't, they couldn't pull themselves out of the tailspin. So American music went into a tailspin. It's never recovered, actually. It's never recovered. They didn't like American music. You know, the corporations didn't like American music. They wanted something to pull us in a direction that they wanted to pull us in, which is really sickness. Sickness. The Beach Boys made us feel too good. They wanted us to feel bad. Come on. They wanted us to be more frantic and hyped up. You know, more caffeine, more caffeine. The Beach Boys, they didn't really want to drink caffeine so much, you know. It's not really. He kind of just said, hey, the weather's great. Let me just have a natural groove here. But the other stuff said, no. And, you know, drugs, I need drugs, you know. Let's get all kind of hyped up and frantic and gritty, and make sure you drink a lot, drink your alcohol and smoke your smokes. And hey, they've got some other drugs for you. Beach Boys are too clean-cut, all-American, clean-cut, religious, you know, help that might lead to religion, you know, wow. The corporations want us to divorce us from religion, which they've managed to do culturally. So they introduced this music, Tavistock, and other think tanks, and behind-the-scenes operators orchestrated, you know, general overall trend in a certain, you know, the big music companies and producers and all these people are very connected to the intelligentsia. Intelligentsia knows all about music and how to use it psychologically to you know, to condition people in the way they want to have people conditioned. They're very aware of it. They use some, you know, the musicians also, a lot of them were fringe intelligentsia, Illuminati, actually, a lot of them. They were. A lot of them were for military intelligence, actually, the musicians. In various intelligence communities, they're very hooked into it. And so there's a certain vibe that they wanted. Like the Doors, for instance, his dad was a big, you know, Navy commander. Jim Morrison's dad was heavily, heavily connected to the military-industrial complex and the high levels. And so the Doors' music was very subversive, actually, leading to drugs and decadence and wickedness and cultural decline. Very much it was. You could feel it. You listen to it now, it's like, good God, you know, yuck. Not that it wasn't talented. You know, they had some talent. But, you know, you get the right people helping you shape your music, and you can make it sound pretty good. I know we're talking about music, but music's really important because most people find themselves attracted to music, listening to music, a lot of musicians, okay? Now I don't even play a musical instrument anymore. It's hard to believe, but it's true. Talk about a change. Talk about a sea change. There was never a time in my life when I did what wasn't playing a musical instrument. Started out with piano, then I shifted quickly to guitar, and then I just, you know, would basically be playing all sorts of stuff constantly. If it's not guitar, I'm on keyboard, synthesizer, you know, ukulele, harmonica, whatever, you know, the drums, you just, whatever, bass, acoustic guitar, you couldn't just, I was always playing some musical instrument. And now I don't play any musical instrument at all. Musicians can't believe it, but it's true. I don't even desire to, actually. But I do sing. I do sing. Singing gives you some space, doesn't it? It's more inviting. Connects it at a more spiritual level than instruments do, actually. I mean, you get the classic country, then I slip key, piano, Pig Robbins playing slip key, or something, one of the great, you know, slip key players, Floyd Kramer or whatever. And, you know, you got the pedal steel players like Peter Drake, did a lot of the studio work. And it's like Hawaiian music meets gospel, you know? It's just like, that's so awesome. I mean, Hawaiian music's so beautiful, isn't it? It's so spacious and ambient. And then you get the gospel, so wonderful and full of grace. And then you combine the two and you get this classic country sound of Hawaiian music meets gospel music. And it's just like, wow. You can feel the spaciousness. You can feel something. So I was super fortunate to, the Holy Spirit made sure I came across that music. And then that really reformed me out of rock and roll, out of pop music, all that stuff. And I left it behind, which was great. It was killing me. Pop music, really, it's very clever and sugary coated and nice, but the lyrics and the even the Beach Boys lyrics are terrible. It's all about, you know, romance and the guys just saying, I can't live without you. You know, the girls are so amazing. I just can't live without you. And all this kind of stuff. You know, God only knows what I'd be without you. You know, it's just nature worship. Idolatry of nature, really. Because bodies are just nature. It's idolatry of nature. So I don't like the lyrics. But that's what sells, you know. That's what sells. That's why they, you know. But most pop music is just trash. The lyrics are complete trash. And there's more poetic stuff. I remember Donovan. Back in, Donovan was great. Loved Donovan in the 60s, right? It's just beautiful, wispy music. Very, very spiritual. A lot of good music, but then things got pretty heavy. And the pharmaceutical corporations, the big corporations, said, you know, start cracking the whip. Said, we want you to be really mentally ill. So, here we go. You know, the stuff was. I mean, it was terrible. I mean, I played all that stuff, like Lou Reed, Ozzy Osbourne, you know, all Led Zeppelin, and all this kind of stuff. I mean, I played all those songs. I could, you know, listen to them. And I even got a Les Paul Jr. like Lou Reed, and I was trying to stay current with the culture, but it was, you know, these people were all sick, mentally ill, really they were, mental breakdowns, mentally ill, and they're promoting mental illness. Actually, that's what happened. Sit in your room and be mentally ill. That was what was hip. And that's what we all did, basically. A lot of us. It's like, oh yeah, okay. Take drugs, sit in your room, be sick. Okay, that's what being hip's all about. That's what the yoga chicks of that time wanted. Okay, they think I'm hip. Are you sick yet? Yeah, I'm really sick. Oh, great, man. I love that. You're kind of cool. hookers for the pharmaceutical companies. Because pharmaceutical companies told him, hey, that's how you'd be really cool, man. You need to hook up with a guy who's mentally ill. I mean, you're like really high society then, right? So they'd say, okay, are you mentally ill? I need to hook up with a guy who's mentally ill. You're not? Well, something wrong with you, huh? I mean, really, that's how it was, honestly. And right now it's so crazy, it's hard to describe. But yeah, literally, if you weren't mentally ill, like you were like, oh, you're not really part of hip society. Not part of like the in crowd, and you're not going anywhere, man. You're gonna be left behind. So, but if you're really mentally ill, then the more mentally ill you were, the more they looked at you like, well, you're really avant-garde. That's cool. That turns me on. I mean, I love avant-garde. I'm mentally ill too. It's like, let's be mentally ill together. What a magical mystery tour we're on. The magical mystery tour is coming to take you away. Coming to take you away. Right? Yeah. Let's go on this magical mystery tour of mental illness and sickness, which the society and culture is now, and the, now just about everybody is hooked on drugs. We call them. Doctors are prescribing them, so we don't call them drugs, really. I mean, it's just, I'm just, I'm under, yeah, I'm under some medication, Yeah, I'm heavily medicated, and, they're just sucking the blood out of you. And music, more than anything, helped take us there. But they had, it's a multifaceted approach through all of culture, education, activism, music, and media, advertising, commercials, and experts, think tanks, psychologists, psychiatrists, drugs, you name the whole thing. It was all designed to get us to where we are now, where we're like scared. We're scared of truth. I'm not scared of truth, but that's because I made a conscious, deliberate effort to get free of all this stuff. So you can get free of it, absolutely. It's all just a fantasy, actually. There's nothing blocking you at all. There are no obstacles to overcome, really. We've just think it's hip to believe there are obstacles. The yoga girls tell us, hey, you really turn me on, when you fighting against all these obstacles, that's really a turn on. Well, really, there are no obstacles. Sorry, I guess you're not gonna be turned on. There is no on or off, There's not turned on, there's not turned off. There are no obstacles. That's all just a fantasy, egoic fantasy. So we absolutely, one little insight settles it all. Completely frees us from the big bad Wizard of Oz. Completely frees us from, absolutely, all regrets have never happened. Not just for me, but for you, for everyone. No regrets even exist at all. One simple little insight just pops up, and then poof, the whole universe of regrets vanishes. So the corporations, they don't want that to happen, right? So they're always, but they're very nervous always, like, wow, we really have to crush it more, because it still seems like, something could happen, And the thing is, you got to realize they can never crush it. So it's a waste of time going down this road that they're taking you down. It's a complete waste of time. It will always be the case that that one little insight will settle it all for you, for everyone. It's always there. You can never escape it. Can never escape it. It's just a simple shift of your will. You just decide. Oh, I want to see it this way. All regrets, boom, gone. They never existed. How long does it take to get rid of what's never existed? Ask yourself that question. How long does it take to get rid of what's never existed? All right, what kind of process do we need to get rid of what has never existed? And how much time does it take? And how much space does it take? And what kind of form does it take to get rid of what has never existed? Okay, this is a very key question, isn't it? In order to get rid of what's never existed, how much time, space, process, and form do we actually need? Just hear this, you know. You don't have to answer it because, you know, it's a no-brainer. So don't you know, it's a complete no-brainer, right? So just abide in this no-brainerness. How many computers do we need calculating and doing their thing to get rid of what has never existed? How much computational power do we need? How many smartphones do we need to get rid of what's never existed? How many bodies do we need doing all this stuff to get rid of what's never existed? How much time, space, process, and form do we need? How much processing power do we need to get rid of what's never existed? How much processing power do we need? Spin the wheels here on the skateboard. You know, spinning the wheels like Dharma prayer wheels, right? Let's see how they're spinning. Beautiful. They both kind of stop at the same time. Let me spin these. I'm spinning the wheels here like a prayer wheel. Let's see. They both... Wow. Virtually stopped at virtually the same time. So the tension on the wheels is like is really balanced. If I could... You know, I can't really spin all four at the same time, but I'll try and see if they all four just stop at, you know, just the right same time. Okay, there's... Yeah. Wow. That's nice. Skateboard Dharma wheels. Skateboard prayer wheels. Skateboard prayer wheels. I'm just like spinning the wheels like this and just, you know, just say, okay. There you go. And spin them this way too. These are, I think, steel bearings, but you can get ceramic bearings. They're really expensive. I think they call them bones or something like that. Swiss bones. I have a something decal about that. Ceramic bearings are supposed to be awesome. They last a long time. It's like incredible. But hey, I don't really want to go to that fast. Those are the guys in the skate parks doing all these crazy stuff. They use those ceramic bearings, but I don't want my wheels spinning too fast, actually. Actually, I'd rather have bearings that didn't let the board go so fast, tell you the truth. Can they make some bearings that actually, I could tighten the wheels, couldn't I? And that would make the board go slower. I never thought of that before. I have this little tool here that I can actually tighten the wheels and slow the skateboard down. Hey, I wonder if that'll do the bearings. I don't know. But that's a thought, isn't it? Because you get on these skateboards and it just like moves like just like glass, like you're on glass. You know, if you're on pavements, like glass, like ice. But if you tighten the bearings down, put this, that would slow the board down, wouldn't it? I never thought of that. So I just like, you know, torque on this and tighten it up. Because you can tighten them down so it like, let me tighten this up. There, the wheel hardly moves at all. You see that? Wow. That would slow the board down. That's amazing. That is really cool. I never thought of that. And I can loosen it up. So if you're like going on a flat area, you might want to loosen them up. If you're going downhill, you might want to have this ready. Say, I'm going to tighten my wheels up because this is... You want to have just a little wobble. That's a little wobble there. It's a little too much wobble, so I'll adjust them, tighten them up a little bit. Let's see. Still too much wobble. Okay, there you go. Okay, now they're back to their spinning with just a little bit of wobble. Okay. Wow. That's just like revolutionized my whole thought process right there. I never thought about it. I've been thinking, how can I slow the skateboard down? Drag my feet? You know, what do I do? In all the years, I've never thought of just tightening the bearings on, tighten up the wheel so it's like almost stuck. It hardly moves at all. And then you can go down a steep slope and the skateboard will just kind of have the automatic brake on it. That's amazing. I've never heard anybody say that. That is so awesome. My God. That just completely flipped my future. Just flipped it. And you know what? I just flipped it an hour and 10 minutes before I turn 60 years old. Turning 60 on the 19th of August. So I'm like an hour, basically an hour away from turning 60. It's almost 11 o'clock. And suddenly, just before I turned 60, I suddenly flipped the script here on how to slow things down. And today I suddenly decided I could sing background. This has been an amazing flip scripting day. Yeah. I'm a flip scripper. Be a flip scripper. Skate satsang, I'm a skate satsang flip scripper. Okay. I don't know what this thing's for. I haven't figured that one out yet. Oh, it might be for these. Let me see. Oh, it is. Okay. You can tighten. Oh, that's tightening the trucks to the mount. Okay, cool. I see that. This tightens these trucks to the mount, this thing. Which, that doesn't really affect the, how your skateboard works, actually. Okay. This adjustment does. This is the turning, how the skateboards turn. I don't want it turning too much. So, I got these little... Yeah. Because then, it's like, whoa, you get a little too curvy. But you can adjust those. And the guy told me, just tweak it. Just work on it, adjust it. I didn't know what he meant, but now I do. This is pretty interesting. Wow, multi-purpose tool here, for say the least, by Section 9. They can make all, you can do all these kinds of adjustments. Adjust your board. He said, just adjust your board the way you want it. I said, really? I can do that? Yeah. I didn't understand quite, really, what are you talking about? Adjust my board. He said, everybody they just set up the way they want to set it up. Well, I think, okay, I have to set it up, then I got to stay with that setup? No. They didn't say, hey, if you see a certain run you want to do, set the skateboard up for that run. Now, if it's kind of steep, tighten the wheels and loosen the trucks, okay? Loosen these trucks up so you can turn, weave really easily, okay? Whereas if it's more of a flat, gentle grade and you want to kind of go faster and carve it faster, tighten the trucks up so it doesn't turn so easily, and then loosen up the wheels so you go faster. Isn't that wow? Completely new concept. I never had ever thought of any of this stuff. But it's just easy once you see it, right? It's easy once you see it. Golly. So in other words, I thought, you adjust it and then that you're stuck with that. Basically, you keep the same adjustment for years. No, you can just adjust it for whatever terrain you're on. You decide, I want to skate this. Just adjust it for that run. And if it's a little too fast, say, whoa, I'm going to tighten the wheels a little more. If it turns too easily, tighten it up, or vice versa. If you're just cruising on a sidewalk, you want the wheels loose and you want the trucks probably tight, so you're not you don't your balance if you're not if you if your balance is being moving, it doesn't cause the board to turn so easily. So you want to tighten that up. So you can turn it into a more of a cruiser or more of a carver, depending on the adjustments you make. So they said this board is very versatile. You can use it for anything, which is I guess why I got it. The Holy Spirit said get this one, and it's you can use it for anything. Oh my gosh. It's mind-blowing. You suddenly get the picture, whereas I thought I was stuck and so limited, and now suddenly I see, oh, I'm not at all. It's just because the dread of skateboarding is you're on a kind of a steep slope, like a path that goes along, and it's kind of a narrow path and it's steep, and you think, oh my God, how can I do this? I'm going to go too fast. I'm going to wipe out. I've got to drag my foot or to carve too many turns. And now all I got to do is tighten up the wheels, and then I can just like stand on the board and just kind of go nice and slow down this narrow, steep path. No problem at all. Just cruise gently, cruise down it with tight wheels and tight truck and loose trucks. Tight wheels and loose trucks. It makes it easy. This just completely opens up like a complete new landscape for me, mentally, physically, emotionally. This is a huge wow. It kind of like evaporates, vast amount of fear is just suddenly evaporated. And again, you can carry this tool, just carry it in your pocket. And can just easily stop in like a matter of 10-15 seconds. You can just readjust your board like that. How cool. We didn't do that back when I skateboarded at all. I never did that. Never did that. Idiots. What were we thinking? And no one ever told me you could do that. You kind of adjust the board the way you like it, and you kept it that way. Nobody ever said, hey, just keep adjusting it and keep changing it depending on, exactly how you feel and what you're skating, and you can do it, 100 times a day if you want to change it. Nobody ever said that. Isn't that bizarre? It's been since 60, 63, 64. Phew, 50 years or more? And it never occurred to me until suddenly right now what the secret is to skateboarding. That's the real secret. Good Lord. That is shocking. You do have brakes, just the tires. I said, why don't they make a skateboard with brakes? You need brakes, come on. Well, you have brakes. Now, what if you do a steep section and come to a flatter section? Well, guess what? You could hop off your board and make a quick adjustments. What's the big deal? Right? I mean, the idea is you can't stop, really? How stupid. We think, no, you gotta make the run. You can't change anything. What do you mean you can't change in the middle as you're going along? You finish the steep section, get to a flatter section, loosen the wheels, loosen the tension on the bearings, stop, loosen them, and then skate on. Get to another steep section. Now the thing is, if you would steep, level, steep, level, if you do that kind of thing, well, then that's a different issue, and you might want to put them somewhere in the middle, But most things are not like that, so you can always talk about an exception. We're talking about the rule here. I'm like, how do I skate down this road down to the beach? It's like really long, steep, winding road. My gosh, I'll go too fast. It's crazy. Well, just tighten the wheels and you can just cruise down there. What? Yeah, wow. That is so awesome. Of course, in California, every day is skateboard weather, basically, 365 days of the year. And it's kind of a beautiful connection with more than even bicycles, certainly more than cars. As you can stop and walk for a while, then get on the skateboard and skate and move, kind of glide, and you're close to your environment, and then you know it's a different experience. Because roller skating is kind of cool too. You don't see roller skaters anymore here. It's just died, disappeared. I can't even remember the last one I saw. Rollerblades, they're gone. At least here they are. Here, what you see, you still see skateboarders. You see quite a few guys walking around. Yeah, so the skateboard is still pretty hip. You see a lot of scooters, younger kids with scooters, a lot of those. And then a bunch of weird electrical stuff that people are using, all these this new inventions here of mobility. Hoops, kind of electronic hoops that you step in and you go along like that. I said, what the heck is that? There's a lot of, you know, they're trying to invent the personal Segway for kids or something here. There's hoverboards here. There's a lot of electronic research going on what's the next cool thing for kids. But why wait for that? Why not jump on a skateboard? I don't know. We'll see. I made a point of going and buying this wrench. I said, you know what? I just feel like I want to get this wrench. I got a good one. And suddenly I see now, this is really key. So you see how your life can suddenly change. We talked about sudden change. I just had a sudden change in my life. Sudden change in my life. This can happen, can't it? This can happen. If you're just willing to experience it, the wow of it, you can have your whole landscape can shift and change, and a tremendous amount of fear can just evaporate from you like this. And you just stay in the wow of it. Just say, wow. Don't do anything about it right off the bat. No, just wow. I'm not going to start skateboarding right away. I'm just going to say, hey, okay, and just see how it feels. Don't predict anything. Once your landscape changes, don't predict anything. Don't make any predictions of how you're going to do it, how you're going to handle it. No, just say, I'll just get used to it. That's all. I'll just get used to it. This is now my new landscape, and my job is just to get used to it. That's it. You know, kids are very adaptable, right? They say, okay, oh, you went on a trip. Oh, this is my new landscape. Okay, well, they do. They look around, let's play this way, and they start playing, and before you know it, they're running all over the place, and what's happened, they've gotten used to the place. They know where everything is. Oh, yeah, why? Because they run all over the place playing. So, you know, you just get used to it, the new landscape. You just get used to it, whereas if you can't do anything, you feel like, oh, I can never get used to it. I'm scared of the landscape changing, mental landscape. But so I will just see how it goes, that's all. It's a new landscape for me now, suddenly. Whew, wow. Happy birthday. What a birthday present. You know, flipping the script. Suddenly it happens. It's great. Singing background, deciding to sing background. That was just an enormous change for me, massive change. I just suddenly decide, okay, I'll do that. I'll do it. I'll do it. This is what I want to do. I'm happy to do this. That's just like, I never in my life ever thought that. Never. Never even crossed my mind that I would be a background singer. Never crossed my mind. And I use this metaphorically, maybe literally too, but never did it cross my mind until today. And I just suddenly said, oh my gosh, I can do this. I didn't know I could do this. I mean, I can actually be a background. Really? Holy cow. Yeah, I'd like to be one. That'd be great. Can you believe that in my 60 years? I never, ever even crossed my mind that I would ever could ever be a background singer. This is not even something that I even considered. Like it doesn't exist in my landscape. And today I said, wait a minute. Yeah. That'd be really cool. You don't think that like touring with George Jones would make you a better singer and better musician? Of course it would. and introduce you to the big time, you know, and all this stuff? Man. Yeah, what a tremendous experience. Without all the pressure, you know, that's great. You know, you got a hoarse voice, don't worry. Jones will cover it. There's no problem. You know, you just don't worry. Just show up. Get on stage, show up and sing, and don't worry. See, when you're a kid, you always want to go fast. So it never occurred to me to tighten the wheels. We always want to get them as loose as possible so they go as fast as possible. How stupid. It never occurred to me to tighten the wheels. That was like the worst thing possible. You know, you tighten, you got your wheels tight? Well, what an idiot. Why would you want to do that? Good Lord. To slow down when you're going down some insane hill, that might be a good idea. Instead of crashing 20 times, you know, you might want to tighten your wheels. Never occurred to us. Never occurred to us. Wow. There's a vestigial stupidity from childhood, huh? from youth just showed up here. I just finally saw it. And again, youth, it never occurs in a sync background, does it? No, I'm going to be the star. I'm going to sing. No, it never occurs to us. Yeah, I want to be excitable. Ah, it's boring to sing background. Never occurred to. Wow. So two huge maturity leaps in as a birthday present. That's pretty awesome. Man, I'm just my mind is just like almost, you know, not spinning, but I'm in a big wow, because this just suddenly just sheds different light on my life. Which is great. That's what we want, right? Don't we want this? Don't we want to have some new, better light shine on our life? Of course we do. Of course we do. So, very great. Okay. It's happened. Put the board away. So everything has flipped, hasn't it? I think I got a shirt here that tells it all. Okay, there you go. Flip, just like that, you know. It all just flipped. But a positive flip. Great positive flip happened. Okay, this is very wowish, and I'm just gonna go chill out. Have to go take care of some stuff. So, yeah. See, this is what it's really about, is the discipline, the determination, the stick-to-itiveness, allowing new light to emerge. This is what we have to do. So just stick with it. Stick with it. Don't give up. This is just an example of what happens. This is an example of what happens. Okay? Very great. That's it for this one. What do I do? Stop capture. Okay. Stop the capture. Would you like to continue? No, would you, if you, yeah. Continue, what does that mean? Continue stopping it or?